I speak to you for the first time as Prime Minister in a solemn hour for the life of our country, of our empire, of our allies, and above all, of the cause of freedom. A tremendous battle is raging in France and Flanders. The Germans, by a remarkable combination of air bombing and heavily armored tanks, have broken through the French defenses north of the Maginot Line, and strong columns of their armored vehicles are ravaging the open country, which for the first day or two was without defenders. They have penetrated deeply and spread alarm and confusion in their track. Behind them, there are now appearing infantry in lorries, and behind them again, the large masses are moving forward. We have been clawing down 3 or 4 to 1 of our enemies. In cutting down the German bombers, we are fighting our own battle, as well as that of France. After this battle in France abates its force, there will come the battle for our island, for all that Britain is and all that Britain means. That will be the time. In that supreme emergency, we shall not hesitate to take every step, even the most drastic, to call forth from our people the last ounce and the last inch of effort of which they are capable.
The lightning drive which follows the German breakout at the Meuse covers 200 miles without pause. It is an extraordinary military achievement. The Germans themselves are astonished at their own success. By May the 20th, the armored formations have reached the English Channel. In 10 days, the war has swept to within 30 miles of the British mainland. Within a week, Boulogne is surrounded and Calais besieged. With the pincers of the German advance only 10 miles apart, the bulk of the British Expeditionary Force and part of the French First Army retreat towards the town of Dunkirk. By now, the British have lost almost all their heavy weapons. Units must fight tanks with no more than machine guns and grenades. Then, against all hope, the German armor, poised to administer the final blow, is suddenly withdrawn. The panzers are instead to strike towards Paris. However, the Battle of Dunkirk is far from over. In Britain, a momentous decision has been taken. The British Expeditionary Force is to be evacuated by sea. Churchill warns the House of Commons to prepare itself for hard and heavy tidings. He does not say that the government expects to save only 35,000 of the 300,000 men trapped at Dunkirk. From the beginning, the evacuation seems destined to prove a colossal failure. Ships that survive the gauntlet of air attacks, minefields, and torpedoes find themselves under heavy fire from the German guns at Calais. Once inside the harbor at Dunkirk, the bigger ships find the waters too shallow, and only 7,000 men can be taken off on the first day. On the second day, a new approach route yields better results. Under fierce air attack, the ships rescue 47,000 men. But the price is heavy.